I would invite you to stand this morning and open your Bible to Song of Songs chapter 3. And when I finish reading this chapter, I'm going to say the words, "The word of the Lord," and I would invite you to respond by saying, "Thanks be to God." Let's try that. The word of the Lord. Very good. Song of Songs 3. Solomon presents this bride-to-be saying, "On my bed by night, I sought him whom my soul loves. I sought him, but found him not. I will rise now and go about the city, in the streets and in the squares. I will seek him whom my soul loves. I sought him, but found him not. The watchmen found me as they went about in the city. Have you seen him whom my soul loves? Scarcely had I passed them when I found him whom my soul loves. I held him and would not let him go until I had brought him into my mother's house and into the chamber of her who conceived me. I adjure you, O daughters of Jerusalem, by the gazelles or the does of the field, that you not stir up or awaken love until it pleases. What is that coming up from the wilderness like columns of smoke, perfumed with myrrh and frankincense, with all the fragrant powders of a merchant? Behold, it is the litter of Solomon. Around it are 60 mighty men, some of the mighty men of Israel, all of them wearing swords and expert in war, each with his sword at his thigh against terror by night. King Solomon made himself a carriage from the wood of Lebanon. He made its posts of silver, its back of gold, its seat of purple. Its interior was inlaid with love by the daughters of Jerusalem. Go out, O daughters of Jerusalem, and look upon King Solomon with the crown with which his mother crowned him on the day of his wedding, on the day of the gladness of his heart." This is the word of the Lord. You can be seated. In his novel, The Count of Monte Cristo, Alexandre Dumas presents Edmond Dantès suffering terribly in prison for 14 years. And those years of suffering provide the context for a tremendous education that Dantès receives from his fellow prisoner, the Abbé Faria. And then Dantès escapes from prison in a death and resurrection that involves a substitution. Faria dies, and what happens is Dantès gets himself into the body bag, which is then dumped into the sea. And the dead man then rises, and Dantès rises to visit justice upon those who had wrongly imprisoned him. Along the way, Dantès buys a princess out of slavery, whom he later marries, and then when he enters the society to which he will visit justice, he enters like a mysterious ruler from an eastern land. He comes into Paris like a column of smoke coming up from the wilderness. It's really a fabulous story, and it appeals to us and resonates with us because Dantès is able to bring off such a satisfying resolution. He himself not only goes through a kind of death and resurrection of his own that enables him to bring retribution on his enemies, he also, figuratively speaking, raises the bride-to-be of his adoptive son from the dead. So in a sense, his own resurrection enables the resurrection of his son's bride. And throughout this story, Edmond Dantès is in sovereign control of everything that happens. He plans, enacts, directs like a conductor in full control of his orchestra. He judges the guilty, forgives the repentant, and saves the poor and needy. It would be great, wouldn't it, to have someone like Edmond Dantès on our side. Someone who could do justice, grant forgiveness, work salvation for those we love. This plot, again, resonates with us because it subtly imitates the true story of the world. In the true story, there is a better hero than Edmond Dantès in a bigger plot than the one written by Alexandre Dumas. And in Song of Songs 3, we will see an anticipation of this better hero in the bigger plot. In this chapter, we see King Solomon coming to his wedding, answering the eager longing of the bride. And the description in this scene is going to point backward to the covenant that Yahweh entered into with Israel at Mount Sinai, and forward to the grand consummation of all things at the marriage feast of the Lamb. So let me say a word before we look at Songs 3 about how I'm approaching the Song of Songs, how I plan to interpret this passage that's before us. The first thing I want to say is that we're dealing here with poetry. It's not an engineering textbook. We don't want to read it like an engineering textbook. So poetry often is suggestive, and often in poetry, authors intend to evoke other passages of other texts, and they mean to perhaps layer meaning upon meaning. So I'm going to argue that there is a real human relationship depicted here, but that human relationship also stands for and points to the relationship between God and his people. And I can say this on the basis of the way that the Bible more broadly deals with marriage. So as early as Exodus 34, the people of Israel are being warned not to whore after other gods. And by being warned not to become spiritual adulterers, it's already being assumed that the covenant that Yahweh is in with Israel is a marital covenant. Or perhaps we might say that marriage derives its meaning from the way that God relates to his people. And then with this, as we've just heard Gunnar read from Psalm 45, there's this wedding song, and in the middle of that wedding song, the king of Israel, did you hear the words? Is addressed as God. Your throne, O God, is forever. And then he goes right back to talking about how he's been anointed, so it's clearly addressing the king of Israel. There are other things that we could say from the Old Testament, but I need to press forward, and I just want to note a few things from the New Testament. When Jesus arrives on the scene, and they say to him, why don't your disciples fast? Do you remember what he said? He said, you don't fast when the bridegroom is with you. So Jesus comes identifying himself as the bridegroom who is going to initiate this new and better covenant, which is like a marriage. That's what's stated by Paul in Ephesians 5 and also by John in Revelation 19:7 when he speaks of this marriage feast of the Lamb. And Jesus also said that one greater than Solomon had come. So I'm going to approach the Song of Songs at these two levels, that there's a real human relationship being depicted, but that the author of this poetry, whom I take to be Solomon, intended for that real human relationship to do the same thing, only in a positive way, that Hosea intended his poetry to do, his prophecy to do. Hosea presents this relationship between himself and Gomer as a kind of parallel, you might even say as an allegory, of the relationship between Yahweh and Israel. And I think Solomon intends to do the same thing with this relationship that he depicts. So let's look together at the bride's longing in Song of Songs 3, 1 through 5. And let me just front load some application for you here. I would suggest to you that there are two ways that you can respond to this, one at the human level and at the spiritual level. At the human level, you want to heed the adjuration in verse 5. We'll get to that. At the spiritual level, I would suggest that you want to use this passage to stir up your longing, your expectation for Christ to come. We're told in the New Testament, blessed are all those who have loved his appearing, and the bride is communicating something of that here in Song of Songs 3, 1 through 5. She says in verse 1 here, on my bed by night, I sought him whom my soul loves. I sought him, but found him not. I want to point out two things here. First, the bride here is speaking of her bed, not their bed. And I think that this fits with a broader kind of unfolding narrative that is gradually revealed for us in an impressionistic way as we move across this poem. That is to say, this poem is not, I don't think, a historical narrative of Solomon's own autobiographical experience. I think what Solomon is doing in the song is presenting an idealized version of himself in this poem. And so the fact that this is her bed, on my bed by night, I think shows that the relationship has not yet been consummated and won't be consummated until 4:16 through 5:1. So I think there is a kind of progression through the relationship here that the details bear witness to. Second, this phrase here, on my bed by night, you could render this on my bed in the nights. And that's relevant because some interpreters look at this and they conclude that the bride is relating a dream that she had. Well, I don't think we have to be that specific. For one thing, if this is in the nights, I wonder how many of you have dreamed the same dream over and over night after night. I think it's perhaps more likely that this has a dreamlike quality and that she's communicating the way that night after night in her bed, between his invitation to her, if you look at 2:10, my beloved speaks and says to me, arise, my love, my beautiful one, and come away. And then Solomon is going to sing this song of spring to her, inviting her to come and be his bride. Between that and the actual marriage that is apparently going to happen on the day that 3:11 depicts, with the king crowned on the day of his wedding, between the invitation to come away with him and the actual marriage, there's this nightly longing for the king. So I don't think that we have to take this as even a historical account of some kind of dream that the bride has. I don't think we have to be certain about the circumstances, but we can be certain about the sentiments, can't we? The sentiments being communicated here are definitely sentiments of longing and yearning. It's a kind of archetypal image to have a single person, in this case the bride, lying in bed by night, pining for her beloved. That's what's depicted here. And this is the essence of what it is to long for the companionship that will be enjoyed in marriage. She says both in verse 1 and in verse 2 that she sought him but found him not. Look at the end of verse 1 there. I sought him whom my soul loves. I sought him but found him not. You see this again at the end of verse 2. I will seek him whom my soul loves. I sought him but found him not. In between those two statements, at the beginning of verse 2, she says, I will rise now and go about the city in the streets and in the squares. So she's lying in bed, longing for her beloved, and she's so constrained by these emotions that she has to get out of bed and she begins to search through the city looking for her beloved. If you're here this morning and you're married, I wonder if you remember what it felt like to be engaged and to be yearning for the wedding day, to long for the consummation of the betrothal. Let me invite you to give thanks right now for your spouse if you're married. If you're here this morning and you're single, I know that many of you can identify with what this bride feels. And it's a good and right thing. God Himself said, it is not good for the man to be alone. So if you're here this morning and you're single, I would just encourage you to look at this passage and be encouraged by the way that things work out for the bride. It's not a guarantee that your desires for human love are going to be realized, but there is a deeper meaning to this love that will be fulfilled. In verse 3, she says, the watchman found me. Just by way of observation here, let me note how this word found occurs in verse 1. I sought him, but found him not. She didn't find him. Verse 2, I sought him, but found him not. She didn't find him. Verse 3, the watchman found me. And then finally, this is going to be resolved in verse 4. Scarcely had I passed him by when I found him whom my soul loves. So clearly there's an emphasis on seeking and finding here. She says, the watchman found me as they went about in the city. Have you seen him whom my soul loves?" Did you notice how she keeps referring to him that way? Him whom my soul loves. Every one of these first four verses, he's referred to that way. I sought him whom my soul loves. I will seek him whom my soul loves. Have you seen him whom my soul loves? I found him whom... The repetition builds the tension, doesn't it? And that tension is finally going to be resolved there in verse 4. So no sooner has she passed on from the watchman in verse 3 than she finds him in verse 4. Scarcely had I passed them when I found him whom my soul loves. And the building tension, it explains for us. It makes it natural, understandable, why she would say at the end of verse 4 there, "I held him and would not let him go." We can understand that passionate embrace because of the way that the author has built the tension for us. And then she says, "Until I had brought him into my mother's house." This may be part of wedding celebrations and the culture of the way that weddings were celebrated in ancient Israel. Back in Genesis 24, 67, Isaac had brought Rebekah into Sarah's tent, his mother's tent, and there she became his wife. So when she brings him into her mother's house, this may be part of the wedding celebration in Israel. And we read in a couple of places in the Old Testament about these week-long celebrations of weddings. So you remember that Jacob served Laban for 7 years, and then he celebrated the week of the marriage for Leah, and then another week for Rachel. So there may be a week-long wedding celebration, and part of this may involve this going to the mother's house. We're not exactly certain what all these celebrations would have entailed. But she says, "Until I brought him into my mother's house and into the chamber of her who conceived me." Then she says in verse 5, "I adjure you, O daughters of Jerusalem, by the gazelles or the does of the field, that you not stir up or awaken love until it pleases." The gazelles and the does of the field are animals that other comparisons are going to be made with throughout the Song of Songs. They're graceful, lovely animals. And I would suggest that in the imagery of the Song of Songs, these animals encapsulate the fertility of the land and God's blessing on the land of Israel. So this is a land that the rains have been regular on because the people are walking in obedience to the Torah, because a righteous king is enforcing the law in Israel. And as a result of their righteousness, God is, as he promised to do in the blessings of the covenant, causing rain to fall on the land, and the animals are being fertile and fruitful. And by the does and the gazelles that point to the blessing of God on the land, she adjures them not to stir up or awaken love until it pleases. Until what pleases? Until love pleases. That's the antecedent of that pronoun. Until love pleases. I think what she's saying is there's an appropriate time. There's an appropriate time when love will please for you to go forward. Don't stir it up until that time comes. Don't stir up or awaken love until it pleases. It's obvious, isn't it, what she would be saying to the daughters of Jerusalem. You need to wait. You need to wait. You need to preserve your purity. So this passage, Song of Songs 3, 1 through 4, depicts a young lady who is frantic to find her betrothed. And as I've noted, in each one of these verses, she's referred to him as him whom my soul loves. You know, there's another poem in the Bible that depicts someone in the night meditating, yearning, and longing. In Psalm 63, a Davidic psalm, David says, "O God, you are my God, earnestly I seek you. My soul thirsts for you, as in a dry and weary land where there is no water." And then a few verses later, he says, "When I remember you upon my bed and meditate on you in the watches of the night." So in Psalm 63, David is meditating on the Lord and yearning for the Lord in the watches of the night. The vocabulary is not exactly the same. If it were, I'd be happy to say that Solomon, who comes obviously after David, is perhaps using the language and imagery of Psalm 63, but the language is not exactly the same. But still, the concepts are the same, aren't they? There are synonymous concepts with Solomon, as it were, dramatizing the longing and yearning that David felt for the Lord in this depiction of the bride's longing and yearning for the king. And on the basis of this, we can reflect, can't we, on the way that the more we want something, and the longer we have to wait for it, the more satisfying is the realization of our anticipation. If you've waited in purity, the postponement has intensified the fulfillment of the desire. And if you've been faithful, if you've earnestly desired, when relief comes, we feel the truth of Proverbs 13, verse 12. Desire fulfilled is a tree of life. That seems to be what's depicted here. And in the next passage, we see the desire fulfilled. In verses 6 through 11, the king comes, and he comes like columns of smoke from the wilderness. I'm going to suggest here that Solomon intended for his audience to hear in his depiction of himself things that would point them back to the Exodus from Egypt and the making of the Sinai covenant and then the progress of Israel toward the land. So why would Solomon do that? Why would Solomon describe the entrance of the king, this poetic figure of Solomon? I don't think this is the historical Solomon. I don't think Solomon is doing an autobiography in this song. I think he is presenting an idealized portrait of how things ought to be. So I would take the song as a kind of implicit confession of his sin and statement of repentance and articulation of the way that things should have been in his own life. Why would he use imagery from the Exodus from Egypt and the covenant at Sinai and then the entrance into the land? Well, what better imagery is there? What is more significant in Israel's life? What better captures what marriage is about than the imagery of Israel's covenant with Yahweh and enjoyment of life in the land? Look with me at verse 6. Solomon presents the bride saying, "What is that?" The NIV renders this, "Who is this?" I think that's perhaps a better translation here. "Who is this coming up from the wilderness like columns of smoke?" It's almost like the pillar of cloud and flame are leading the people. "Who is this coming up from the wilderness like columns of smoke, perfumed with myrrh and frankincense, with all the fragrant powders of the merchant?" The terminology that's used there, myrrh and frankincense and the fragrant powders of the merchant, if we were to go back and look at Exodus chapter 30, we would see that this myrrh is used in the oil that was prepared for the anointing of the tent of meeting and the ark of the testimony. And then it's also used for the anointing of Aaron and his sons. And I would just observe here that in the Pentateuch, the only people anointed are the priests. So that when eventually a prophet is instructed to go and anoint Saul and then one of the sons of Jesse, it's going to lend a kind of priestly overtone to what Samuel is going to do in anointing the king. So I think there's a kind of merging of priest-king concepts there with this idea of anointing. Also, the frankincense that's named here is used in the incense that's to be put in the tent of meeting. So all of this, the columns of smoke, the myrrh, the frankincense, the fragrant powders of the merchant, this would work the way that when we hear certain terms in our language, we automatically think of certain concepts. So if I were here to say the words, a house divided here in Louisville, Kentucky, immediately what's going to spring to your mind is a house where you've got UK fans and U of L fans. And it's a house, well, I didn't say anything about UK or UL or sports. All I had to say was a house divided. I guarantee you that's what Mr. Parker over here was thinking. Verse 7, the answer, who is this or what is this, is answered in verse 7. Behold, it is the litter of Solomon. Around it are 60 mighty men, some of the mighty men of Israel. A litter is a palanquin or a sedan chair. This is a box-like structure that maybe has a tent-like fabric over it, and it's got poles run through the corners, and those poles are going to be carried on the shoulders of select men. Does that sound familiar? This is precisely the way that the tabernacle and the Ark of the Covenant were transported through the wilderness. A box-like structure, the Ark of the Covenant, maybe the tabernacle. What's that symbolized, by the way? The presence of the Lord, right? And now you've got the man who is the image and likeness of God. It's like he's the new Adam, describing his own entrance into Jerusalem for the consummation of a covenant. And he speaks of himself this way. Don't read it like an engineering textbook. The litter of Solomon, around it are 60 mighty men. Do you remember how Israel came out of Egypt and went through the wilderness? The tribes were in martial array around the tabernacle and the Ark of the Covenant. And Solomon, it's like he's reduplicating that picture here. There's probably also a doubling of David's 30 mighty men with these 60 mighty men of Israel. In verse 8, we read, all of them wearing swords and expert in war, each with his sword at his thigh against terror by night. So things are working at two levels, aren't they? At one level, what's being communicated is that this king who's entering into Jerusalem is ensuring the safety of his bride. I think that's what she's to take from this. The king is going to protect me. No terror by night is going to attack me. And there's also glory here, isn't there? The glory of Israel's wisest and wealthiest king parading into Jerusalem for the day of his wedding. It's a magnificent scene. And then at the same time, as I've said, we're pointing back to the Exodus from Egypt and forward to one greater than Solomon, for whose coming we look. Verse 9, King Solomon made himself a carriage from the wood of Lebanon. Do you remember what else was constructed from the wood of Lebanon? The temple, right? Who was it that was the seed of David, who was going to be raised up by the Lord to build a house for my name in 2 Samuel 7? Well, that turns out to be Solomon, doesn't it? Verse 10, he made its posts of silver, its back of gold, its seat of purple. If you go back again and look at the tabernacle narratives, these colors and these fabrics are all over the tabernacle. Its interior was inlaid with love by the daughters of Jerusalem. So I think we're overloaded in this passage with points of contact between this palanquin that Solomon presents, this idealized version of himself being carried into Jerusalem in, and the tabernacle and temple narratives from earlier scripture. Just as the Lord came out of Egypt, residing in the tabernacle, enthroned above the cherubim, over the mercy seat of the Ark of the Covenant, borne along by the poles on the shoulders of the priests, preceded by pillar of fire and cloud, Solomon presents the king coming up like a column of smoke from the wilderness in this box-like, covered moving tent that's carried on poles on the shoulders of those who serve him, surrounded by his special forces, arriving in the city of the great king for the consummation of the covenant. And then, having spoken of the handiwork and the care with which all of this is constructed, verse 11, the bride summons the daughters of Jerusalem. She says, go out, O daughters of Jerusalem, O daughters of Zion, and look upon King Solomon with the crown with which his mother crowned him on the day of his wedding, on the day of the gladness of his heart. So it seems at this point in the poem, we've come to the celebration of the long-anticipated wedding. It also seems, as I've said, that all of this is presented in terms that are intended by the author of the poem. So I'm suggesting that Solomon intended for us to see a correspondence between the king in the psalm and Yahweh and the bride in the psalm and song and Israel. And this is going to fit naturally, I think, with the way that Christ comes for his bride. Solomon himself stands in the line of descent of the seed of the woman, whom the Lord has promised to rise up and crush the head of the serpent. And this wedding has pointed back to the covenant between Yahweh and Israel, and also forward to the one between Christ and the church. So if you're a single person here this morning, and you're longing for a spouse, and maybe you're thinking to yourself, that's what's going to satisfy me, I would ask you to indulge yourself in a transposition of that longing. Use the emotional energy that you feel to long for the day when Christ will come and take his bride. Stir up the longing that the bride has recounted in Song of Songs 3, 1 through 4. Place a boundary around that she articulates in verse 5. And then trust that in God's good time, Christ will come just as he was seen to go. And feast your imagination on the glory of that day. As great as Solomon was, as impressive as this parade of his palanquin would have been, it's going to be a greater day when the Lord Jesus comes. A better Savior is coming than the Count of Monte Cristo could ever be. At the end of that long novel, Dumas presents the Count of Monte Cristo writing a letter of counsel to his adopted son, Morel, and to the bride that he raised from the dead so that Morel could marry her. As he parted from them, he wrote these words. Tell the angel who will watch over your future destiny, Morel, to pray sometimes for a man who, like Satan, thought himself for an instant equal to God, but who now acknowledges with Christian humility that God alone possesses supreme power and infinite wisdom. Perhaps those prayers may soften the remorse he feels in his heart. As for you, Morel, this is the secret of my conduct towards you. There is neither happiness nor misery in the world. There is only the comparison of one state with another, nothing more. He who has felt the deepest grief is best able to experience supreme happiness. We must have felt what it is to die, Morel, that we may appreciate the enjoyments of living. Live then and be happy, beloved children of my heart, and never forget that until the day when God shall deign to reveal the future to man, all human wisdom is summed up in these two words, wait and hope. If you were to ask me what I think the main thrust of this passage is, the bride's longing. Long for the coming of the beloved, and then a worshipful admiration of the glory of the king at his arrival. Wait and hope, my friends, for he will come like a column of smoke from the wilderness. More fragrant than frankincense comes the one whose presence the Ark of the Covenant represented, almighty power to protect. Danger of night will be no more. Better than the temple itself, the king will come to Zion, crowned for the day of his wedding, to claim his bride who will be clothed in fine white linen. 10,000 times 10,000 will throng about him, waving those branches of palm. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Let's pray together. Father, we long for the day when Christ will come. And I pray, Lord, that you would use your word to create in us a longing that is stronger than that a yearning bride would feel for her betrothed. And Father, we pray that you would give us imaginations that would begin to approximate what the glory of Christ will be like when he comes. Lord, cause us to have thoughts that are worthy of the splendor of his wealth and wisdom and power and glory. Help us to worship him, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.